synergize very well with these other major research institutes. So FAU, we get ourselves on the map with this new facility, the state and privately funded. So at the Brain Institute, we have two major goals that are collaborative with each other. We go back and forth. One is to discover the essentials of brain function, the chemicals, the molecules, the proteins, the circuits that make us human, essentially. And we work our way up from very small creatures, actually into cognitive neuroscience, theoretical neuroscience, on the different campuses that we occupy. I'm a very translational neuroscientist, and that means that what comes from this process, we want to move here to an understanding of brain disorders. I'm a child of a family racked with mental illness, and I'm seeing the consequences myself and dedicating what I do to doing as much as possible to help bring an understanding of neuroscience into the treatment of brain disorders, mental illness, and the like. And you'll get a taste of that today. One of the other things I wanted to tell you about the Brain Institute is that we built a community forward institute. This is not an ivory tower research academic institute. This is something that I've been passionate about for decades, having come from having worked with science centers and museums in Nashville. I brought my role here and found outstanding partners at the South Florida Science Center. And just this past March, if you don't know, we opened a multi-million-dollar human brain permanent exhibit. It's dazzling in my mind. It's high tech. It's a little something for everybody, and I think you'll be very proud to see this in Palm Beach County. So please go visit. All right. So the path I'm going to talk about today, in terms of why it is that we care about animal models of brain disorders, is that it allows us try to move as quickly as we can from the disorder to new therapies. And by therapies, for me, that's medication. It's not the only way to treat a brain disorder, but it's the path that I know the most about. So with autism, why do we care? We have no FDA-approved medications that treat the main traits, the main symptoms, core features of autism. We've taken the approach of identifying risk genes in individuals with autism and use that information to find brain circuits and pathways that we think are not working properly. And that if we had something that could help from the laboratory, this might affect the lives of millions of people. So with those genetic changes that we've identified in humans, how do we get into the brain and take it apart and really understand the chemistry and the biology there? Well, we're not going to do that in humans. We should be doing that in humans. So we go to a small mammal that has a nervous system, much like ours, evolved on the same pathway as ours, and we can learn a lot by editing their genome to carry these same genetic changes. And investigators across the world are doing this in many neuropsychiatric disorders, trying to come up with changes in these animals that are predictive of the ability to make medications. And so I'll tell you about that now as I go through this. And I figured that for today, we work in both autism and ADHD and a number of other disorders. The path I'm traveling is very similar in all cases. So I thought I would just concentrate on the autism one today. But I'll say a little bit about ADHD here. So you may know that the most recent report for the incidence of autism has really brought to our attention how common it is to be on the spectrum. 1 in 59 births now are estimated to be on the spectrum. There's a 4-to-1 male to female ratio. We don't really understand that, but we have some clues from the laboratory. We can talk a little bit more about that later. Some aspects of the genetics, I thought I would just tell you why we think this is a highly genetic disorder. So if you have a sibling who has autism, you're 25 to 50 fold times as likely to have traits of autism themselves that suggest some kind of shared biology. And if you look at identical twins versus fraternal twins, that's a tenfold increase there. So with a much more similar genome, you have higher increased risk. This tends to point to a genetic basis. And now scientists across the world have many, many studies showing that this is one of the most genetically loaded brain disorders that we have. And as I said, there's nothing we have that treats the core symptoms at present. And so here are the main core symptoms. This has been lumped together now in sort of two domains, but I still like this because it has some statistical value and it helps us think a little bit about our animal models. So we have rigid compulsive repetitive traits. This is an anxiety domain. An insistence on sameness that, if perturbed, can really be difficult to deal with for the individual, for the child, for the family. Language deficits, so there's a delay in language or even a frank inability to fully acquire communication skills. And then social interactions run the gamut from very mild to very, very debilitating. But there are major factors associated with autism. This will give you a little indication of the complexity of the genetic architecture of autism. So here are the chromosomes laid out. And in red, we have what's called rare and syndromic mutations. These are ones that are carried by a very small number of individuals or are part of a syndrome like Fragile X syndrome, where we can see frank changes, big changes in the DNA. That will, without a doubt, give those changes, will give rise to a disorder with the features of autism. The rest of these green, and there's not as many there as there are today, these are risk factor areas. These are genes in those areas whose changes on their own don't give a full-blown disorder, but in combination with the rest of the genetic architecture, increase the risk and build and build and build. So with this landscape, this is very daunting for us to say, we can do a simple test and predict you have autism. So what can we do? Well, I and several others in the field have been working on way of simplifying all this genetic variation. But what's plotted here in different colors are different genes. Each circle represents a different gene. And what we can see is that individual colors are associated with things we already know about the brain. How it develops, how synapses that are the communication spots between neurons are built and work, how sensory information is encoded. Individuals with autism have sensory issues, sensory aversion, problems being touched, or even maybe excessively like to be held and relaxed by that. And then others that are involved in cell signaling mechanisms and even hormonal changes. So now we've collapsed what was several hundred elements into a few major pathways. And this is not all there is, but one of the, in this blue area, cell signaling, for the nervous system, that means neurotransmitters, brain chemicals that one neuron releases to activate another. And we've been on the trail of one particular neurotransmitter that you may know something about, and that's serotonin. Serotonin, this is just a picture of the molecule itself at the bottom. It's also abbreviated 5-HT, you may see that. Serotonin is the neurotransmitter for a cluster of neurons here down in your brainstem and your midbrain area. And it's particularly the ones sort of in the top part of this group of little orange neurons here that project up into the forebrain. This is the areas of our higher consciousness. But these neurons also project deep into the brain. They control sleep, they control mood, they control appetite, they control keto. There's very little that serotonin signaling doesn't control. So why is it that we should be interested in this molecule? Well, first I have to tell you a couple things because it's going to relate the particular molecule we care most about. This is a junction, the synaptic junction, where one neuron is talking to another. So we call that the presynaptic side, and this is the postsynaptic side. So just where the sparks are going between my two hands here. When that goes on, this neuron has a small little sphere inside of it. Actually, has hundreds of these, and they're packaged with this green stuff, which is serotonin. When this molecule, when this compartment fuses, they don't hear it, drops, not by gravity, of course, but these molecules move to target proteins on this side and change the activity of the next neuron. And, you know, this is a dizzying thing that's going on in your brain all the time. And this is a plastic phenomenon, meaning it changes with time, it changes with learning. Your synapses, I hope, are growing right now, are getting strengthened somehow. Maybe you're weak. I don't know. I don't know what that is. Now, this is a signal, and all signals have to be turned off. And the way that this signal is turned off is via a little vacuum cleaner, a little nano vacuum cleaner. This is a protein here. It's much bigger than serotonin. It's not shown even to scale. But what happens is that this little protein has the ability to suck the serotonin away and keep this signal limited, right? So it's kind of a push-pull. You send your serotonin, you take it back up. And this is happening for 100 billion neurons who each have 1,000 synapses. So trillions of synapses are doing this right now. So when serotonin is released, this transporter takes serotonin back. And if you mess with the activity of this protein, some interesting things happen in brain function. Now, the thing that you may know the most about serotonin, and even that protein, the serotonin transporter, is that it's a target of very powerful, what we call psychotropic medications. One of which is Prozac, right? Prozac is a drug, it's called an SSRI, type antidepressant drug, and it binds to this protein, and it basically plugs the hole. So what's going to happen, right? It's like your vacuum cleaner, all of a sudden, it goes up because there's something stuck in it, and the dirt in your household, there's no dirt, but it's analogous, is going to build up. That can be actually therapeutic if this signaling is not working very well, or if you just need a boost here over time. This neuron is going to sense that, and it's going to change its structure and the circuitry that's in it. So when I was a graduate student, this is all we knew about this synapse. We knew that we had drugs, we needed better ones, treatment of depression, and that it bound to some protein. We had no idea what it looked like. We just drew these little proteins because we knew there was something there that would interact. But back in the early to mid-90s, we and a number of other groups cloned a gene that encodes that protein, that little vacuum cleaner. And I won't go through all of the DNA stuff, but I'll tell you that one of the exciting things that we found when we cloned this gene was where it's located. Remember all the dots I was showing you, right? We want to know what underlies each of those little areas that geneticists are telling us are risk factors. So by getting this gene, we were able to map it to chromosome 17, a little spot on chromosome 17. And that's important because we want to see if it lines up with any of those areas that are risk factors for different disorders. And given that the serotonin transporter, or SERT, as I'll abbreviate it from now on, is a target for antidepressant medications, what disorder do you think we had on our sights? What was the disorder we thought we were going to be studying? Depression, right? And this was close to my heart, having a father that we lost from that, and other members of my family are affected. So that's what I wanted to do. Science sometimes takes you where it's going to take you, right? And that's the trajectory, the excitement actually in doing science, is you try to figure out, does it apply here? Now, others took this gene, and the pharmaceutical industry used it to identify new medications, and I've been a consultant on the development of those. You may have heard of Lexapro or Paxil. These are drugs that having this gene allowed us to develop. But in the laboratory, we discovered something very interesting. And that was that in an embryo, these molecules, these serotonin transporter molecules, were being expressed extremely early. So this is a rendition of this from a mouse. So this is a mid-gestation embryo. It's a section through an embryo brain. And what you see at mid-gestation, these little white speckles, shown along up here, remember those clusters of serotonin neurons I showed you in the cartoon? This is them. This gene is being expressed in an embryo and very actively expressed. And by this time, the nerve fibers are actually moving from these neurons up into the developing cortex. And that's true in us as well. So with that, we began to think about not adult onset disorders. Many people begin to suffer from depression or depression-like disorders, certainly present in adolescence too. But we began to think about early onset disorders. And we began to think about that and remembered something. And this is, again, fortuitous because I happened to train with one of the people who did these early studies. And what had been shown in individuals with autism by Shane and Friedman back in the early 1960s was that in the bloodstream of individuals with autism, there is a population of individuals with autism who have elevated serotonin in their blood. Now, it's shown here in the distribution study by this group. And what I've shown you in white here is the normal range of serotonin in the bloodstream. And you can see that there's a peak right here, and it comes down. And if we didn't have this, it would just come down. And this would be the sort of mean level of your serotonin in your blood. In individuals with autism, a group of them have another peak over here. In fact, their peak is moved. It is right here. And that's called hyperserotonemia, and it's present about 25 to 30%. Of autism subjects. So this suggested to us that there is something going on with serotonin in early life, and it relates not to depression, but to autism. So let's see how far we can get with that story. And what we did, and I'm going to cut through a lot of very difficult gene hunting and mutation hunting, but what we ended up finding were five hotspots within the protein made by the serotonin transporter gene. So this is SERT here. It's a protein, and it snakes through the membrane of the cell 12 times, and it folds up into a little barrel. And through that tube, essentially, serotonin moves. That's the vacuum. And what we found in these red spots here were sites where the DNA had changed and was making the protein different. Now, these were rare, but they were largely never seen in individuals who did not have autism. And one of them here was common enough that we could study it much more actively than the others. This one is present in about 3 million people in the U.S. So we got interested in it, and we did some studies. And what we found, you may be used to thinking about DNA changes and risk factors as damaging to a protein or to a gene. They kill, and a lot do. But in this particular case, what we found amazingly compares to the normal serotonin transporter or applying its ability to suck up serotonin. All of these, including this very common one here, G56A, actually have better activity. They remove serotonin much more efficiently than the normal serotonin transporter. So the consequence of that, of a vacuum that is now going, as they say, in spinal tap up to 11, is to suck that serotonin away before it can work. And you need it. You need it in development for for synapses to develop, and we've worked on this a bit, and the number of the synapses, if this is acting irregularly, do not develop in parts of your cortex that are involved in sensing the world, that are involved in emotion, and that are involved in social communication. So seeing this, we began to study this very actively, but, and I'm not going to go through all the cell studies. I want to cut to the chase and get to the mouse that we made with that genetic variation. So we engineered that most common variant, or gene mutation, into a mouse. And if you want to know how that's done, spend an hour talking about it, but then the proof of concept is that there are features of that mouse that resemble what's happening. Now, we only say, you know, mice are not little people. They're not. But who in here doesn't know an animal with a trait that you use human terms to describe? My shelter is the most anxious animal on the planet. You know, not even thunder, but like it's miles away, or hears it on television, and he's under the couch. Okay? Other animals will excessively gnaw their paws, or they might even spin in circles. These, and some, have narcolepsy, and we've been able to identify genes for narcolepsy, seeing that behavior and following the trend. So it's with that that we take advantage of our ability to change the genes within a mouse. It's not as easy to do this in a larger animal, and they live way too long for us to be able to hang around long enough, keep the funding that's needed to do studies of an organism that's going to live for many, many years. So we used a mouse, we did that, and we first went and looked for that biomarker in the bloodstream that I told you about, right? The hyperserotonemia. And what you see is that this mutation causes hyperserotonemia. We saw this, and you can imagine, we do these experiments blind, we send samples off, we wait anxiously for the data to come back, and bingo, right? And that's a great day. We want to close up shop and never do anything else again, because maybe the rest of it's going to get more. But frankly, it's actually been really an important model for us. Now, I told you the story that this transporter mutation causes the transporter to work better, right? And those were in vitro studies. So we could put serotonin on the cells that had the mutation and see it pull that serotonin inside the cell much more actively than a normal one. But does that happen in the brain itself? So to show that, we have to come up with an approach where we can actually monitor how good that vacuum is inside the brain. So the way we do that is inside the brain of a mouse, we insert a small fiber. It's the size of a human hair. Right, and we insert it into a small part of the mouse brain, and next to it we have a little very finely glass tube into which we shoot serotonin into the brain near this fiber. And the cool thing about this fiber is that it can sense serotonin. And when the fiber sees serotonin, even electrical discharge on this fiber, we can monitor that. Here you see it. Here's the application of serotonin. Boom, the fiber just saw serotonin. Now what happens with it? Just like in a synapse, it goes away. It's sucked away, right? The rate, and it's about as technical as I'm going to get today, the rate of this fall is how fast the serotonin is being pulled away from this carbon fiber, because that's the source of the signal. So you can monitor this rate as an indication how active that gene product is. And this is what we found when we did the study. In gray, the Gly56 copy of the gene cleared serotonin with this rate. This is what we found for the mutant transporter. You see it's clearing it much faster than the wild type. that says these transporters are acting in overdrive. They are pulling the serotonin away from its synapses, just as predicted from the in vitro studies. But now this is in a living animal in their brain. Okay, the consequence of that is twofold. One is that the serotonin signal is not getting where it needs to go. And this is particularly damaging, we think, in early development. But it's continuing, because those studies that I just showed you were in an adult animal. So it's not like it happens in development and then quits. That protein, as you know from being a target of Prozac, is there in an adult suit. Right, so we can work with an adult animal that's carrying this gene mutation. And what we also found when we recorded from individual serotonin neurons in the brain, and we monitored their firing rates, okay, this every spike is in that neuron going pow, 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 firing in response to various stimuli. That's its activity pattern. But look at the activity pattern of the mutant mouse. Its serotonin neurons are going. Yeah. It's like your heartbeat slowing down. All right? What happens? Well, each of these little spikes triggers the release of some serotonin, triggers the release of serotonin. So with this kind of signal, now what's happening? A little bit of serotonin, a little bit of serotonin. And in the background of that, take it away faster. So we got two hits on this system that are depriving the brain of its serotonin signal. So that was pretty interesting. All right, well, neither of those assays are things that look like autism. We don't diagnose autism by putting a fiber in your brain and not measuring your serotonin. We don't actually record from your serotonin neurons. That's not something that we can do yet. What we can do is look at the behavior of these animals. And after all, autism is a behavioral disorder. So what's the behavior of autism? We have various assays, and up in our facility in Jupiter, we have what is called a behavioral core facility. That allows scientists to take a mouse, a living, happy mouse, and ask various questions about its motor behavior, its sensory behavior, its social behavior, even its ability to communicate with each other through ultrasonic vocalization. So we can take apart this phenotype. What we see here is a simple assay where when a mother mouse gives birth to a bunch of offspring, and we remove the mice and take them away from the mother, what happens is that these babies start to squeak. They want the mother, come get me, and bring me back to the nest. Okay? This is an early form of communication. What happens in these animals, these are the normal animals, they squeak quite a bit. These guys, they don't squeak. They're not communicating with the mother. This is a response that is seen in these animals. It's seen in a number of other mice that have been engineered to carry different mutations of autism. So we were very excited to see these data. There are different ways to do this, and we can tell it's not the mother that's squeaking based on the patterns and the frequency of vocalizations. And so we were very eager to keep going with this and see what other things we could do. And we wanted to look at social interactions that were in adult animals, right? What can we do there? A very simple assay that you can do, it uses a small cylindrical tube, it's only about the size of a mouse inside. But the mouse, once he enters, cannot turn around. Has to keep going forward or back up. So you take a mouse and you train it to run down this tube. Really easy to train these mice. You put them at the entry of the tube, and you poke them in the rear end with a little pin, and they don't want to have that happen again. So you put them in there, and then they do, then they're the part of this test, one of my clinical friends calls this the McDonald's playland test, which is the kid that's up there, and coming down, and encounters that that kid that wants to go down. Okay, so you take another mouse that you've trained, and you put it on this side, right? They're going to meet in the middle. Now, if those are two animals that are have a normal copy of the serotonin transporter gene, about 50% go one way, 50% go the other. Right? They're essentially identical animals because they're also inbred animals. They're genetically identical. There's no preference one way or the other. This is what you see in an animal that has the mutant serotonin transporter. You see it's tabulated as the number of wins, and these guys win less. The mutant guys win less. So that means they come to the middle, and they decide they're backing out of that too. They're much less likely to essentially cause the other one to back out or push it out. So there's something about that interaction that's unfavorable for them. And like, I guess, the ultrasonic vocalizations, I have to remind the inquiring newspaper reporter who wants to know what's in their head that makes them want to back up. And I, you know, if they talk to me, that would be great. And I can't even interpret what they say in those ultrasonic vocalizations. I'm Dr. Blakely, not Dr. Little. So this is what I can tell you, is that they back up. We're very interested in the possibility that this is sensory aversion, because the individuals from which we got the mutation, if you look at their autism compared to all individuals with autism, they're loaded up with sensory aversion traits. So we think that's meaningful, and we're exploring that right now in the laboratory. Okay. So I've given you a small sampling of the traits of these animals. They have repetitive behavior as well. They show certain odd responses to drugs that we give them that tell us there's something wrong with the serotonin system. But that's a lot of work to go through, and I want to do that. I want to get down to that final part in that pet, and that's the development of medication. We've got a few assays in our hands that we know don't look right. If we could come up with a treatment, maybe we could affect the behavior of those animals and reset them. Now, that's only going to occur if what happened during development is reversible. Right? So if something happened in brain development that's so major that it changes big parts of brain structure, we're not going to affect that. But if you look at the brain of individuals with autism, you really don't see anything with modern approaches. There's nothing structurally abnormal in individuals with autism, most of them. Some very severe forms, yes, but most of them, no. So that gave us some optimism that we could treat adult animals with a medication if we could develop one. And I'll tell you one that we have now gotten to the stage where it's very close for clinical trials. It's being tried actually now. It's almost finished in its safety test for its use in relation to brain inflammation. And the reason for that is that the deep down in the molecular control of the serotonin transporter, there is a pathway that's common to the inflammatory pathway. I don't want to overstate that in the sense that you think these animals have an inflamed brain. It just happens to be that the molecules are shared between how you control that little vacuum cleaner and how the brain responds to inflammation. But it's very important that we found that link, because somebody was developing a drug to deal with that inflammatory signal. And we asked the question, might it be useful for these mice? Might it then be useful for people? Good question. We haven't yet tried that. There are certainly, you know, it's a degree thing, right? So if you have brain trauma, if you have damage to your brain, that generates a big inflammatory result. We think that there is an inflammatory component here, it's small, and yes, that might be a diet control. When you treat something doctorally as a scientist, that's a very complicated thing. You know, food products are full of things, nutraceuticals are all kinds of stuff. So we go after a molecule that we know what it is, a single molecule. Sometimes it takes a few things combinations, but a single molecule is what we were hoping for, and we found one. So a collaborator at Northwestern University had developed this experimental drug here. It's called MW150. His name is Marty Watterson. So he puts his initials on this until they start calling it, you know, whatever. I don't know what to call it. Anyway, so this is the drug. I'm sure it's really meaningful for you to see that. But it's an enzyme inhibitor on that inflammatory pathway. So we said, please give us that drug and let's see what we do. You remember the slide I showed you that had that rapid clearance of serotonin? That's in red, so you see that. We gave this drug once a day for a week, and this is what we got. We have now normalized this more rapid clearance, and now it's slowing it down. It didn't go away, it's still there. If I put Prozac and block this transporter, this line would go like this. It'd be very slow, which is what Prozac is supposed to do. For some people, it's going to take away that clearance, and there's going to be a lot of serotonin out there, right? We just wanted to slow it down a little bit. We thought that might be a better way to take a look at this pathway. So that was very exciting. That was another one of those days where, you know, I can't believe you're fortunate.
Excuse me, is that for depression or autism?
Which one?
The results.
Well, so that's in that mouse into which we have put this mutation we got from individuals with autism. Okay, so one of the questions is, and this is a good question, and it's a common one. Does your mouse have autism? I don't. It has some features of autism. It has issues with repetitive behavior. It has social behavior issues. There's no reason to think this is an autistic mouse. And my funding agency is the National Institute of Mental Health would slap me if I said that. Okay? But those are features that we care about with respect to autism. Okay? Yes?
We can say that because this might be.
Yep, that's right, exactly that. So in fact, we're very, very lucky. The mice come in all kinds of flavors. There are the mouse fanciers out there who've been breeding mice for over a century. And co-colors, some have curly tails and straight tails, some have big litters and small litters. They're just a whole spectrum of differences, and that's in their genetics. We just happen, for reasons that are experimental, we picked this mouse and engineered this one mutation in it. And frankly, we thought, you know, we might take multiple different mutations, we'd have to put it together. But it was surprising to us, and that we were very excited to see that we could generate this hyperclearance of serotonin by just making this one manipulation. And then we could fix it with that medication, with that experimental medication. Okay, well, you saw this before. These two bars are what I showed you before. Once a day for a week, this is now what the mutant does, right? And while this looks a little bigger than this, and actually looks like the animal's got to push it, you do this a lot, many, many times, these were from the original study, but what we showed in our publications that these are the same. We basically normalized this social behavior interaction with this drug, given, as I said, reasonably acutely. We can't give it once and get anything. We have to get it at least for a week. And in our process, we were going to give it for a week, 3 weeks, 3 months, and see how it went. And we stopped. Because in a week, we had our effects. Now, if this does work in humans, maybe it'll take much longer. We don't know. We'll have to see. Again, mice are not soft. Well, we were excited to, you know, we do our work and we live in our little bubble and we think it's all great, but we want others to see something that looks like this. And the paper came out, our paper came out in 2018 as well, and another lab at Stanford showed that serotonin release in an area of the brain that contributes to reward, social reward. If you augment serotonin, remember, our mood is pulling serotonin away. So if they augmented serotonin in this brain region, it rescued the social deficits they saw in their mouse model. Their mouse model is actually a much bigger change in the DNA. It actually eliminates about 25 different genes all at one time. It's a small break in the chromosome. But nonetheless, this is seen. Whereas ours, I would consider a risk factor, right? Small effect adds up with other things. This one is a syndromic mutation. You have that, you're going to be on the spectrum for sure. And yet they see the same thing we see. But if you augment that serotonin availability, things get better, and they get better in adult animals. That's so important to say.
When you withdraw medication,
That's a great question. We're doing those experiments now. So there are a whole bunch of additional behavioral tests we're doing with the animals and with the drug. We don't know the answer to that. I presume that it probably is the case. I think that serotonin signaling controls plasticity. It's not needed for point-to-point communication that says A is going to activate B and it should do this so many times. Serotonin signal is a modulator of that signal. So I think that you're going to need to keep that going, just like you would need to keep an antidepressant medication going. You can't just stop that and expect everything is going to be working fine. Okay, so this was very exciting. It suggested that we were on the right trail. And so now let me just summarize this work up to this point. So I told you that the changes in serotonin signaling play an important role in human development, and that got us on the road to thinking about pediatric onset brain disorders. A significant fraction of subjects with autism demonstrate elevated blood levels or hyperserotonemia. And I think actually the future with this will probably be in that small group, well, 25 to 30%, that have hyperserotonemia. So that biomarker can be used to pull those subjects away and test them. Because if we test everybody, there's a lot that don't have that. And the answer will be, doesn't work. So we need to focus on a biomarker-driven clinical study. And that's the path we took in. Multiple mutations I showed you in the serotonin transporter of SERT have been identified in subjects with autism. And all of them increase the activity. That's also really a big clue. If some turn it up and some turn it down, we'd probably be a little more confused. But that's the way it went. And then mice carrying the most common SERT mutation, notice that about 3 million people in the US carry that. They don't have two copies, most of them just have one, and the other copy is a normal copy. Okay, but that one copy, we think delivers risk, and we think two of them really impact risk. This enzyme, and it's called P38MAPK, is a powerful activator of SERT, and experimental drugs that go after that enzyme normalize the behavioral changes in our mice, and it does it in adulthood. And in autism, we do have behavioral opportunities to improve the lives of individuals with autism, of kids. In adulthood, these things don't work as well. Patterns of behavior set in and much more intractable. Learning has been impacted. There are problems that you can remedy with individuals with autism early on. And we want to identify individuals with autism early. But the adult population is really left there without it. And this is something we're excited to see, and so are others who are doing similar studies in their minds. Okay, so what time is it here? It's 9:28. And I know you might have to leave. I just have like 3 slides left. I just want to give you a little flavor of what's going on the ADHD side. It's a little bit of an analogous story going on. We've identified mutations in individuals with ADHD and been very interested in them. Now, you may know that the most common medications to treat kids and adults with ADHD are so-called psychostimulants. These drugs target not serotonin, but dopamine. And in fact, they target the dopamine transporter. It's a brother protein of the serotonin transporter. Well, we've been working on transporters for many years. We know what to do with it when we get it, when we find mutations in the dopamine transporter. And you can see here, this is a real picture of what a transporter looks like. These are mutations in red in the dopamine transporter that we found in individuals with ADHD. Now, all of these are very rare. They're only found in, as far as I know, they may only be found in single families or a few families on the planet. Right? But we found them by knowing where to look, and we've identified them, and we've begun to study them. And so we made a mouse, okay, and it carries a mutation, just like in the serotonin side. Now I've got a mouse and carries this mutation. And we published on this as well, and I'm not going to go into great detail, but I want to show you something that's kind of interesting with respect to behavioral therapy, not medications. We are on the medication side of this too, but this is an interesting phenomenon. This is a mouse in a small chamber. The mouse has a choice of sticking its nose on a little iPad when these light up, these little lights. It's got a little grid, makes little blocks, and the mouse with nose poke, and it learns to do that to get a reward, right? Something good to eat, some water, whatever. So we train the animal to do that, and we have a light here to initiate the trial. They have to sit back and wait in order to have correct responses. So this light will go on, that's the correct choice, but they can't go touch it for 15 seconds. What will a kid with ADHD do? They'll be banging all over that night. Okay, so this is a test of impulsivity. It's used in psychological fields for humans, and you can use it in mice. So we did this with our animals. They carried that mutation, and here's what we found. This is the number of premature responses. They can't wait. What you see is that the animals that have the mutation are showing many more premature responses. They're much more impulsive. Now, I had a graduate student who's, she was incredible, and the number of things she would do, once she had an assay, she'd change it around, and just this, and things I never asked her to do, which is a good sign of a grad student. And she said, well, I train these mice to do this, because it takes a while to train them. You go through many tests, same tests, over and over again. And she said, what if I just mix up the training a little bit? Some days I'll give them 5 seconds. Sometimes I'm in 15, sometimes 30, sometimes and it's not predictable. It's an unpredictable learning environment. They're always doing something different. Then when you look at these animals, they show less impulsivity. In fact, they normalize from more impulsive. And that's really interesting with respect to an educational environment, right? Where you have, and again, I'm anthropomorphizing here, but you have to get your clues from somewhere. But what we're seeing is that how you educate your mice, or my mice, changes the perception of their impulsivity or their emission of impulsivity. So this is not a pharmacological treatment. This is a behavioral change in the environment for these animals, which is making a difference. And in fact, you make this difference and they actually learn faster than the wild-type animals. And there's some issues with their attention, which is very focused, and we think that relates to this greater acquisition, their greater rate of learning if you train them. Okay, the last little bit I want to show you is another cool thing we found with these mice that we had the opportunity to do because of knowing a little bit about the biology of dopamine. So it turns out that in your retina, dopamine is important. It's a signal. So your retina has a lot of neurons in it that are normally sensing light. Send that back to your visual cortex and you perceive the world. So that dopamine signal in your retina is a critical signal for your ability to switch between using your rods and using your cones. So you have two kinds of light receptors in your eyes. Rods are important for dim light, black and white viewing. You go out at night and you see a star, sky's black, you can see, you can actually, your retina will detect one photon. It's very sensitive to it. But there's no color in the world. The cones have to be brought online. You have to bring them into the world when there's a lot more light and when there's a need to perceive color. So what happens is you switch from rod vision to cone vision as the light comes up. The thing that controls that is dopamine. So what we do is we take the mice, and this can be assessed in an animal. You don't really have to do anything but put a little electrode on the surface of the cornea. Can't really feel it. And you flash light. When you flash light, you get a signal. That signal is small or big, depending on the dopamine that's released, because it's telling us how good they switch from dark to light. So what we do is we dark adapt the animals. They're in dark. And now while they're in dark, we hit them with light, just a little flash. And it causes a little electrical signal in their eyes. And we can see that, and you can't even see. You can't even see it on the eye of that mouse. And when we do that, what we find is, and I don't know if I'm showing you the data. Okay, what we see is that we can tell the difference between the animals with that mutation and the normal animals just by looking in their eyes. So for us, this is really cool. If this would work in humans, we could at least figure out which of the individuals we're looking at with ADHD look like our mice. In essence, that they have something wrong with dopamine. This is a complex disorder. It's a spectrum, too. There are going to be many other ways to get there besides having a change in dopamine. And again, if we're going to develop better medications, we need to tailor it. We need what's called precision medicine. Precision training, whatever it is, what's going to work for that individual that won't work for that one? So we need to be able to pull them out. And this is a really interesting way that we've come up with to potentially have a very simple way, non-invasive way to do that. So right now I'm trying to interest my ophthalmological researcher friends into helping me do a human study. You have to recruit in subjects that have a diagnosis. Well, we've done that before, but that's where we got our mutation. So let's recruit them in, put the electrode on them, let's dark adapt them, and let's see if in that group of individuals with also the ADHD compared to normal individuals, we can see these individuals and more frequently than we could in the normal group. So that's the path we're going to go down. And we'll continue with that kind of work. But I hope you've seen how we can move from some very fundamental biology on genes through something that's much more an intact brain, and an animal that can behave, and then maybe develop some treatments. And then it raises more questions, just like the one you asked. Are we going to answer that? Well, I got to go back to the and do some more experiments. And I have to truthfully look at what's going on with serotonin or dopamine in the brain and really understand it, because the devil's in the details. And so hopefully you will know more about that from us and our colleagues at the Brain Institute. Our work has been supported by a number of foundations, private and federal, This is where your money is going, your tax money that you hear about at the NIH is funding scientists like us, where grants to them, about 10 to 15% of those grants get funded. It's very competitive. We don't get paid by the university to do research. We get paid by federal agencies and viewers like you. So thanks a lot, and I'd be more than happy to talk some more, whatever you need. So.
I just have one quick thing to say. I do a project for kids for celebrity or pantry. And recently, in the past year, I've been going back and forth to do makeup and giving back to kids so I could bring them on to the stage. And there's this one specific boy, he's 17 years old, he's an Ocean View. And his family owns this compound. So this, it's obviously third world country, you know, so I go there and he's like, restaurant, convenience store, a bar, restaurant, a music studio, and their house. Okay? And there's a young boy.